mention a second book because it's very germane to some of the things that we're going to be covering. And this is a book called Indefensible, Seven Myths That Sustain the Global Arms Trade. And you can read it for free online at a site called projectindefensible.org. And Project Indefensible is one word, lowercase. And it summarizes, without quite the detail of this book, which has almost 3,000 footnotes, this one summarizes some of the key arguments against the nature and current functioning of the global arms trade. And I almost feel as though the first point I want to make might not even be necessary to make to an audience like this, but I'm going to anyway. And that is a connection that is too infrequently drawn between the arms trade and everything that it embodies and climate change. And there's recently been a very good paper trying to assess the extent of the impact that the arms trade and conflict has on the environment globally. And those impacts and consequences are obviously manifold and myriad. So not just the nature of the equipment that is built is extremely harmful on the environment. If one thinks about jet fighters, if one thinks about how tanks are propelled, for instance, but also the impact of ordnance, of munitions, of bombs, not just on human life, but also on the environment around it. And as I was finishing the manuscript for the Shadow World, I had an extraordinary experience with the arms company BAE Systems, where we had offered the chairman of BAE the right of reply to the many allegations we make against the company in the book, because for about 17 or 18 years, BAE Systems was the most corrupt company on the planet. To give one example, on something called the Al-Yamama deal between Britain and Saudi Arabia, BAE Systems paid £6 billion of bribes, and that's a billion with a B. My own experience of this trade comes directly from experience with BAE. I was an ANC Member of Parliament, serving under Nelson Mandela, responsible for public sector financial management legislation, and I then ran the Parliamentary Committee on Financial Oversight. And as Mandela stepped down from office, his successor, Thabo Mbeki, decided to spend $10 billion on weapons. Weapons that we have absolutely no need for, and that South Africa has barely used until today. The only reason that we bought the weapons were because $300 to $400 million of bribes were paid. Key cabinet ministers who made the decisions about what to buy and who to buy from, to key executives in the state arms company, and to a number of intermediaries, arms dealers, brokers, and agents, and various others. And at this meeting, the chairman of BAE had said to me when I sent him a letter saying, you know my views on your company, we're producing this book, please feel free, I'm happy to meet with you and to report your responses to the allegations I'm making, etc., etc. He wrote back and said, my lawyers advised me not to meet with you, but I am sending one of my senior executives to engage with you. So I went off to a meeting with this woman who was the head of corporate affairs or something similar, and she started the conversation by saying to me, we would like you to help us repair our corporate image in South Africa and Tanzania. Because while they were paying bribes on the South African arms deal of £115 million for one contract, they were paying similar bribes in eight other countries around the world, one of which was Tanzania. So she said to me, we want your help to rehabilitate our corporate image in South Africa and Tanzania. And she said, and we'll pay you extremely well for that assistance. So when I got back up onto my chair, having fallen off it, I said to her, well, I tell you what, I'll give you the advice for free. I said, simply take out in all the main newspapers in South Africa and Tanzania, full-page adverts that list everybody who you to win those two contracts, how much he paid them in bribes, and what they did in return for those bribes. As you can imagine, she quickly lost interest in that conversation before I got on to phase two of their rehabilitation program. But the reason I'm telling you this story is after that, having sort of rolled her eyes at me, she said to me, "Oh, I must tell you that we are producing an environmentally friendly bomb." That's what? She said, "Yes, a bomb that won't harm the environment so much." So I said, "Okay, so it's going to kill people, but it'll do so in a way that doesn't harm the environment as much." And she said, "Exactly, isn't it a great idea?" And as I could have thought of, you know, a few better ideas, but... And so just before the final manuscript was sent to the printers, I contacted her to find out how the green bomb was going. And she said, "Oh, God, no, no, no. We shelved that. It was far too expensive." And that for me really encapsulated the sort of attitude of arms companies and those who effectively fuel and often intensify conflicts to issues of climate change and the environment. So that would be the first reason for thinking about the defense diversification. There are second and third reasons as well. The second reason is because I would hope at some point in the future, and I hope that it's fairly near in the future, the United Kingdom might well have a progressive government. And there is actually the possibility of having a government in this country led by somebody who, for the past 30 plus years, has been an anti-war campaigner. And even though he faces enormous pressures within his party from people who don't share his views about the arms trade and about British foreign policy, the reality is, even in the last election, in the manifesto, there were certain commitments that, if realized, would undoubtedly lead to the shrinking in the size of the British arms trade. Now, if we maintain our current government, it is quite clear that one of the post-Brexit strategies, so desperate will we be to ensure the continuation of Britain's export markets, that they've already made it plain that key to the industrial strategy post-Brexit will actually be an expansion of the British arms trade, in which we will effectively do away with most of the regulation that exists regulating who we can and can't sell weapons to. But I should also point out that while we do have national laws and regulations, while we are signatories to the EU Common Position on Arms Exports, and while we were early champions and signatories of the International Arms Trade Treaty, on a daily basis the United Kingdom violates all of those in its arms exports, simply by exporting to Saudi Arabia. It is violating all of those and making a mockery. So, a post-Brexit environment in which we're trying to expand our arms exports.
Sorry.
Oh, I was told I had 25.
Oh, is it 25? I said 15. Okay. No.
Sorry.
Carry on.
So, the way in which we expand the British arms export market is to sell to more and more countries who are engaged in conflict, be it internal conflict or external conflict. And therefore, we are talking about the least democratic countries on the planet. Now, while we've cornered the Saudi market, there are unfortunately a number of other regimes that are also being visited by people like Ian Fox, the International Trade Secretary, specifically to try and drum up support for further exports of British armaments. So I believe that under a potentially progressive government, we would actually see a shrinkage in the size and nature of the British arms trade. The other reasons for looking at a reduction in the trade are clearly the fact that what we are effectively doing is exporting corruption to the world. BAE Systems and Rolls-Royce, our two biggest defense companies, have been involved in the most extraordinary corruption on a systemic scale around the world. If you haven't seen it, I would advise looking on BBC iPlayer for a documentary on Rolls-Royce called Bribery Around the World, or Bribing Our Way Around the World, to give you a sense of the systemic nature of it. In the case of BAE, the film of my book, Shadow World, deals in some detail with the global network of money laundering that BAE set up to conduct its corrupt deals over almost two decades. Now, the companies obviously claim to have changed, but there is absolutely no evidence that they have. And my little organization, Corruption Watch, what we do is we actually investigate the corruption in the arms trade on an ongoing basis. We are yet to investigate an arms deal that doesn't involve some element of corruption. But then the final reason that I want to suggest, the second last reason is obviously that of the export and promotion of militarism. The arms trade is absolutely dependent on an environment in which conflict is the preferred option to diplomacy when disputes arise. How do we know that this is the default mechanism of the United States and the United Kingdom government, who tend to follow the trail of whatever the US does? Today, the government of the United States of America employs more people to run one aircraft carrier than it has diplomats across the entire planet. The United States of America has 11 aircraft carriers. And if one looks, as we showed in Defensible, at a graph of an increase in defense spending in the US and the decrease in spending on diplomacy in the State Department, you'll see exactly what the trend has been ever since the Second World War. And that has only intensified under Donald Trump. Not that Barack Obama was much better at some of these issues. But the final reason I want to suggest is the economy. Both the economy of the country we sell it to and our own British economy. Why do I say that? First of all, arms deals result in a massive socio-economic opportunity cost. So, for instance, on the South African deal that I mentioned to you, that I tried to investigate as an MP and was thrown out of Parliament for my trouble, we spent those $10 billion on weapons at a time when our President Thabo Mbeki said that we did not have the fiscal resources to provide antiretroviral medication to the 6 million South Africans living with HIV or AIDS. As a consequence of which, according to a study undertaken at Harvard, over the following 5 years, that policy choice resulted in the deaths, avoidable deaths, of 365,000 South Africans, and the birth every year of 35,000 babies who were HIV positive, because we couldn't afford mother-to-child transmission treatment. But we could afford $10 billion on weapons that we've barely used. So if anybody thinks that corruption is a victimless crime, they need to think again. And the impact on both the buying and selling countries of the trade is actually not particularly beneficial. Why do I say that? In the case of South Africa, that arms deal in which BAE Systems and the other four companies involved promised all sorts of incentives for our economy that would offset the costs of the armaments, none of those economic opportunities came to pass. They were all empty promises to get the deals. But even in the selling countries like the United Kingdom, for the amount of public investment investment in each job in the defence sector, in other more socially and economically productive sectors, you could create between 3 to 7 jobs for every single job in the defence sector. So it's an incredibly economically inefficient way to create jobs, first of all. Second of all, I'm a great believer in public investment in the economy. I'm a great believer in the state guiding the economy through industrial strategies. But what becomes crucial in those endeavors is that the limited public resources available are appropriately targeted to those economic sectors that are going to have the best social outcomes and the best economic multiplier effects. So taking all of this into account, we believe that the British defence sector has to look at the issue of diversification extremely seriously. And to that end, we're engaged in a study that has only just recently started, together with something called the Oxford Research Group and an organization called the New Economics Forum that some of you, sorry, the New Economics Foundation that some of you might have come across, in which we are looking to take, and we have a meeting on the 29th of this month to decide exactly what the focus is going to be. But the idea is to take either a city or a region or a company or even a factory and look at what would be viable diversification from an entity that is heavily dependent on the defence sector at the moment to a variety of other industries, on the assumption that the workforce in the defence sector will shift. And our starting assumption is that in retraining people for other related sectors, you can't simply abandon them for the period of retraining. So a key focus of the exercise is to look at exactly what diversification would look like in practice, and particularly examining what it would look like for the workers directly affected, for the communities that those workers come from, and for the state at national, regional, and local level, to try and put a figure on the costs of diversification, not only to the company, but to the state as well. And we are hoping to be able to produce a document that outlines that in very specific, disaggregated economic detail. And that could be utilized as an example of how diversification in the United Kingdom could take place. Because obviously one of the keys to this is getting the buy-in and support of the workers themselves and the trade unions that represent them. And that has always been a difficulty in work that is opposed to the arms trade and the arms industry. And we are hoping that by going to the microeconomic level of looking at what practical consequences of diversification would look like, we might be able to take that debate and that discussion forward with the people who will be most directly affected. What the outcomes of this process will be, I obviously don't know yet. But there have, in my opinion, been too few studies, certainly in recent times, that actually show the practical implications. So there have been a few studies, like in Slovakia and 2 or 3 other countries. But I think any study like this has to be very specific to the economic conditions that the affected workers and communities find themselves in. So, while I might be starting from a different perspective to some people, in that I'm obviously somebody who is not a great fan of the trade in weaponry, the end point is to try and figure out how we can ensure that in the United Kingdom we have, rather than the corrupt, out-of-control arms trade that we have today, and I gave you literally only a smattering of what the reasons might be for the problems with the arms trade as it's currently constituted, but rather look at a sort of much smaller trade that is much more accountable and is actually providing the sorts of things that are needed in this country, rather than the sorts of things that generate corruption on the scale that we have seen and the socioeconomic opportunity costs that go with that. Thank you very much.